My privilege to welcome you to the GCA Church, and if you just arrived, welcome to the campus of Georgia-Cumberland Academy. We are grateful you're here. We have families from across the Southern Union and beyond the Southern Union visiting us yesterday and today for Academy Days, and as you consider school for your son or daughter next year, eighth graders, ninth graders visiting, as you consider where you'll be next year, next August, we pray and hope that GCA will be part of that decision making. And with you, we'll be praying that God will lead and that God will have his will. But thank you for being here today. Thank you for being part of our worship service together. You heard from Sinfonietta this morning, our string orchestra, part of our larger orchestra, as well as the band that performed last night. You'll hear Camerata in a little bit, an opportunity to hear them later today also, and we are just grateful that you can be here to be a part of this weekend, to get a little bit of a taste and a feel for life at Georgia-Cumberland Academy. We do have a few announcements for those who are part of the GCA Church, a little bit of our local church announcement. Church Board and Church Finance Committee will meet this Monday, Finance Committee at 7:15, Church Board at 8 p.m. Outdoor Sabbath is on October 22. We will not be in this. I said April, Nancy. April 22, I'm sure I said April, didn't I? Thank you. Yeah. April 22 will be Outdoor Sabbath, maybe in October also. We don't know yet, but I doubt it. And we'll be at the Lock and Dam Park, which is near Rome, and the address will be available to you on the website. You can figure that out. We'll begin at 10:30. Also, we're looking for students for next year. Coble Elementary is also looking for students. So if you're interested in that for elementary, K-8, then you would want to go on their website and check that out or call Coble Elementary. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, as we continue in worship, we pray that you will turn our hearts and our minds toward you, toward your throne, toward your mercy and your love and your grace. Thank you for all that you do for us. In Jesus we pray. Amen.
Hi guys, I want to welcome everyone to church this morning. Please join us as we praise and worship.
Power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. Son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nation with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of his brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing. Grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing.
morning. Our theme for this Academy Days is fearless. And I want to speak to two groups of people this morning who might be experiencing some fear. First of all, I want to talk to those of you who are here as guests at Academy Days and you're saying, I really like what I see. This is wonderful. GCA looks like a great place for my kids, but there's absolutely no way we can afford this. There's fear. There's fear about the unknown. There's fear about how in the world this could ever work out. For you, I want to share a quick story. We could have the photo of the family up on the screens. All right. I want to tell you about this family. This group of people came to GCA in 1999. The mom in the middle, Shirley Johnston, single mom, a nurse, came to enroll her oldest daughter, Jessica, who is just to her right, just to the left as you look there. Jessica was a freshman. And it wasn't Jessica. And then Megan came. And then Eric. And then Josh. This is a single mom, a nurse. She did not know how this was going to all work out. We spent many times in prayer in my office asking God to supply, to be faithful, to answer those prayers for help. And by God's grace, 12 years of paying GCA tuition, she stood up here at graduation when their youngest son, Josh, up on the right there, when he graduated, she stood at this very pulpit and gave her testimony about how God provided for her four children to come to GCA. Amazing story of how God provided. Those four kids went on to college. Jessica is a teacher. Megan is a speech therapist. Eric graduates from dental school in June. And Josh graduates from Georgia Tech with an engineering degree this spring as well. Amazing story of these four kids and how God provided for them to be there. Okay? So if you have fears about how your child can be at GCA, remember the Johnston family and how God answered their prayers. And I'm here to help as much as I can with that as well. I want to tell you the other group that I want to talk to this morning is those of you, perhaps, who God is calling to generosity at a level you have not been able to experience before. God may be calling you to be the answer to prayers like for families like the Johnston family. But you're afraid. You're afraid to step out and give at the level that maybe God is calling you to give because of your fears. I want to share a scripture with you. This is from 2 Corinthians 9. And this is a cycle of generosity that God calls us to. And you may say, oh, I can't do that much, but when we give generously, when we plant seeds generously, God will give us a harvest of blessing that we can't even contain. Listen to this. Remember this, Paul says, a farmer who plants only a few seeds, so not very generously, a farmer who plants only a few seeds will get a small crop. But the one who plants generously will get a generous crop. You must each decide in your heart how much to give, and don't give reluctantly or in response to pressure. Okay, so no pressure. For God loves a person who gives cheerfully. Here's the promise. Here's the promise I want you to hear this morning. And God will generously provide all you need. That's for both of us, on both sides of that fear problem, okay? Those of us who fear that God can't provide, those of us who fear stepping out in faith and being generous, because again, we fear for lack, we fear for want, God will generously provide all you need. Then you will always have everything you need and plenty left over to share with others. Whether you're experiencing fear about how God could ever make it possible for your child to be here, or whether you're experiencing fear to answer the call of generosity that God may be laying on your heart. God's a big, big God. He can do immeasurably more than we could ask or imagine, Paul says in Ephesians 3. Let's pray. Will the deacons please stand as we take our morning offering? Our offering today is for the Worthy Student Fund. Just so you know, our offering is for the Worthy Student Fund. Your gifts today make it possible for kids like the Johnston family to be at GCA, and those of you who are looking at sending your children here for next year. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you are a big, a God who can do all things, a God for whom nothing is impossible. Right now, Lord, we come before you bringing our fears, bringing our reservations, our hesitations, and we just give them to you. I ask, Father, that you will stir our hearts to generosity, that you will replace our fears with faith, knowing that you can do all things. Please bless this offering today. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
That was beautiful, wasn't it? So happy Sabbath, everybody. I hope you guys are having a good Sabbath. I just want to share one of my favorite Bible promises to you with you today, which is Romans 12:12, which is rejoice in hope, be patient in tribulation, and be constant in prayer. And prayer is such a powerful thing, and I invite you guys to kneel with me as we pray. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I just thank you so much for this beautiful Sabbath day that you've given us. And just thank you for the cooler weather, and God, thank you for this spring day, and God, I thank you for each person that's gathered here today, Lord. I'm thankful that we're gathered here in your house, and we're here to praise and worship you, and Lord, I thank you for the beautiful music and the beautiful praise, and Lord, I pray that you just be with us throughout today and you give us the rest and rejuvenation that our hearts and souls need today. And Lord, I just pray that you be with each person in this room and each thing that they're struggling with, each trial that they're going through, each hard thing, but be with each good thing as well, God. Just be with them in the moments of joy and the peace. And God, just fill each person with your love today. And God, I just thank you so much for bringing us all here and for Academy Days and just for every person and their families that they represent in this room. And Lord, I just pray that you give us that hope and we rejoice in it and that you give us that patience through our trials. And God, I pray that we can be constant in prayer and that we always lift everything up to you, whether good or bad, because God, you're with us through it all, Lord. We love you and we thank you so much for being who you are and for all that you do. And God, just thank you for being the awesome God that you are, Lord. We love you and we thank you so much for this beautiful Sabbath day and help us to find rest in you, Lord. We love you in your precious name, I pray. Amen.
We're talking about fearless. The song that Camerata is going to be singing is, I want to live with God. There's a Bible verse that my mom used to always say when I would walk into her room and just talk and say, wow, why is this happening? What's going on? And she would look at me and say, perfect love casts out fear. That was it. After that, there was nothing else. The song we're singing is, I want to live with God. And our prayer is that every day we want to live with God because we're tired of being here. We're in a good place, but we're ready to go home. So please remember, that's our goal, getting to heaven.
And to Camerata, beautiful music. Camerata leaves this next week for their tour to Colorado and Nebraska. And we're just thrilled that they'll be out on tour this spring. It's time for our children's story. And so, young children, you are encouraged to get up and to come to the front and on your way to collect the Lamb's offering. Dean Nesmith has our children's story this morning.
Good morning, boys and girls. We have a lot of little people, and you brought up a whole bunch of money to put into the little church. Thank you for that. And that money goes to help with the children ministry that we have in our church. And we have some bigger kids up here, and that's good, too, because we're all young at heart. And I'm glad you're here, because children's story is always my favorite part of church, because I think I'm a big kid at heart, too.
Yeah, no offense, but I love the children's story. We're going to have a great time this morning.
We really like children's story, because we can act like kids when we're up here, too. But we're going to tell a special story to you today, and we were talking about what message we wanted to give to you today. And we thought, we've done a lot of different Bible stories, but today we're going to get kind of a strong message. We're going to talk about life.
All right.
There's some really important things you need to talk about life. And so,
like, what's the meaning?
What's the meaning of life? That's going to be a long conversation.
We'll do something else.
But we need to talk about the importance of what to do with your life. And so what should we start with? Well,
we could, we just tell them a story and include a couple things here and there about life, and they're probably good.
And we always have more fun when you have a little bit of acting.
We need an actor.
I don't really want to be the actor, so we need somebody to act. How about Dean Albert?
Where's Dean Albert?
Where's he?
Oh, there he is.
Come on up. Okay.
All right, a great actor.
We're going to tell a story, and you be the actor, and you do the acting part. And we'll all act together, but you're the main actor. Okay, now we're talking about life. Our story is going to be about life. And what could be the best life where we could start from? What would be a great life? I love roller coasters. How about if we were talking about...
Ooh, I don't like roller coasters, man. They make me sick.
Yeah, and I don't know if I want to spend my whole life on a roller coaster.
Let's not do a roller coaster.
So where would I like to spend my life? In a restaurant, in Taco Bell.
I spend enough time around food, as you can tell, so
okay.
We don't need to do restaurants.
And Taco Bell would be a great place to live, but have you ever tried to sleep in Taco Bell?
Yeah.
Well, they always
it's noisy.
Kick you out at 3 a.m., I don't like that.
Right.
So what would be a good place?
What about a cruise ship?
A cruise ship.
I think a cruise ship would be good.
They have beautiful rooms, and then you can stand on the deck and you can be in the very front and say, I'm on top of the world.
They even have water slides.
They do. And life is like a cruise ship.
Yeah, we use a cruise ship.
Okay, so we're on a cruise ship now. I'm going to go to the buffet. Yeah. I'm eating at the buffet.
Okay,
now I'm going to go to the top of the ship and look down and see the flying fish flying.
Did you get enough suntan?
And I'm sunbathe a little bit. Yeah. He's sunbathing. And we're on a cruise ship. What could possibly go wrong?
Oh, nothing. Cruise ships, man, everything's great.
Attention all staff and guests. This is your captain speaking.
What?
We have an emergency.
Not good.
Our ship is sinking. We will not be able to save the vessel. Hmm. Abandon ship. I repeat, abandon ship. The ship is going to sink.
The ship is sinking? Of all the things that we could choose, we chose a cruise ship. The cruise ship is sinking.
They're not supposed to go down.
What are we going
to
do? We got
to
do
okay.
Something.
We're
all going to drown. I can doggy paddle, but not that long.
We're a long ways from shore.
What do wait. I think we're safe. Here comes a lifeboat.
Perfect.
Go. I'm glad they have lifeboats.
What kind of lifeboat is that? What?
Well, as long as it's a lifeboat,
at least we're on the boat still.
We can get on the lifeboat, and then we'll be safe.
What kind of lifeboat is that?
I don't know. It doesn't look like a very good lifeboat.
No,
but
not at all.
But we know this ship is sinking, so we have to get on that lifeboat.
Yeah. So what kind of lifeboat are you guys?
Don't know. Don't care.
Did he just say, I don't know, I don't care, and he's a lifeboat?
Yeah, you're a lifeboat. You're supposed to help us out. I mean... So you
well,
can help?
Okay. Here's a lifeboat. Wait, don't get on
don't
yet.
Get
don't
on
get
this
on
one.
Yet.
There's a.
Don't know hold it. Hold
no,
it.
No, 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 no. Don't.
They're so disorganized.
You care.
Wait a minute.
But we're sinking.
There's a hole in your lifeboat. You are sinking. What do you?
Don't care.
Don't know. Don't
you
care.
Stay here with
don't
us.
Get on this lifeboat.
Don't get on this
you
lifeboat.
You guys, you can go save yourselves some other way.
No, stay here with us.
Okay, wait. Our ship is sinking, but you don't want to get on that lifeboat. I can't believe that. I've never seen a lifeboat that had a hole in it before.
Oh, but there's another lifeboat coming our way.
Ooh.
supposed to be. Go. What?
This looks a lot more Everybody drowned in that lifeboat.
Oh, no. I'm glad this one's coming along.
I'm glad we're getting on this one. They look organized. Those guys didn't have any organization.
All right. What kind of boat are you, lifeboat are you?
Well, can't you see we're the work hard lifeboat?
That's a work hard lifeboat. That's good. We should get in that lifeboat.
That'd be a good one right
there. Wait. Well, there's a hole in that lifeboat, too. Do you realize there's a hole in your lifeboat?
It doesn't matter. We're working on We're bailing and rowing the whole time.
No, way. Stay here.
They're bailing water out of their boat. You don't want to get on that boat.
We can't wait here. We got to go. Row.
Row. Bail. Stay here. They're bailing water at the.
We're sinking, but they're sinking too. We can't get on a lifeboat that's sinking.
My feet are getting wet now.
They're organized, but they're not going to survive. You can't get in a lifeboat that's sinking.
Probably could have made it on that one.
I hope another lifeboat comes.
I do too. We'll see. See, they went down again.
They all drowned because there was a hole in that lifeboat.
Wait, what is this boat coming?
Oh, here comes another lifeboat.
What kind of lifeboat are you?
The party lifeboat.
That's what a cruise ship should be like. Wait.
No, stay here. You don't need that.
There's a hole in your lifeboat, too.
You're too young for that.
Oh, come on.
He just said he was going to die at a party.
No, we'll stay here. You can't go. We want to stay.
Don't get in that lifeboat. Right. You guys can go ahead. We don't want to be part of this lifeboat.
I know. It's getting deep.
No. It looked like they were having fun.
Up to our waist almost.
They were having fun, but they're not going to be safe in that lifeboat. That lifeboat's going to sink, too. We better get on this life. I hope this is a good lifeboat because our cruise ship is getting really sinking in the water.
What kind of lifeboat are you?
They said we're the Christian lifeboat.
A Christian lifeboat? What does a Christian lifeboat do? Because we've seen some really bad lifeboats going by.
We've just been going around seeing who we can help. If anybody's in trouble, we're trying to help them.
That's a lifeboat. You can get on.
Do you guys realize there's no hole in your lifeboat?
Yeah, I guess not.
Oh, that's a lifeboat.
That's a good one.
This is the one that you want to get on.
You probably want to get on that boat. Okay. All right.
Are you guys sinking?
No, we're not sinking.
They're not sinking. Okay, you guys are safe.
That's awesome. They're going to help people. All right.
And they're trying to help everybody. Yeah. I'm so glad we found the right lifeboat.
Man, that's great. I tell you. But you know what? There's only one problem.
There's only one problem? What's the problem?
That's not the most important thing.
What's the most important thing?
The most important thing is we need to get on the boat. We're still
Get on the boat.
We're still on the sinking
we're
ship.
We're stuck on the cruise ship? You guys...
We got to get on the boat.
This is the story that we wanted to tell you. Our world is like a sinking ship. This world is going to have an end. But we can be safe. But if we get on a lifeboat that has no direction, we're just going to drown. If we got in a lifeboat that has a hole in it, even if you work hard, you're just going to drown. If you just party the whole time, but if your boat has a hole in it, it's not going to save you. The Christian boat will save you, but the most important thing, like what he said,
getting on.
Is you have to get on the lifeboat. It's not enough to know which boat to get on. You have to get on it. Please bow your heads for prayer. Dear God, please help us to become Christians and to love you with our whole heart, and help us to do that now. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, you guys can go back to your seats.
comes from 1 John 4:11 through 12. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we also ought to love one another.
No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. It's afternoon now, I guess, so we won't take too much more time, but it's incredible. I love being here every Sabbath, seeing the talent, seeing the passion, seeing all the students, seeing the church family, all worshiping together. Let's bow our heads for a prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this Sabbath time. We thank you as we can gather together and be reminded that even though we live in a fearful world, that we can be fearless as we serve you. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, Greg was born in Poland, and when he was about 3 years old, his family moved to the United States. And before long, as he continued to grow, he soon got caught up in the drug culture. He began taking drugs. Soon he began selling drugs. And before long, in his late teen years or early 20s, he was arrested for drug trafficking, for gun possession, and he was sentenced to jail. 9 years in prison. Now, this is not me. This is a different Greg. Just got the same name. Sometimes in life, we look at the situation that we are in, and we think that we've been abandoned. We don't see how God can have any plan for us. It's easy for us to feel like our life is going nowhere, as if we have no direction. Today, in just a few minutes, I want to look at two different stories from the life of Jesus. They kind of bookend the ministry of Jesus. The first story takes place on the second day of Jesus' public ministry. And the last story takes place on the next to last day of Jesus' ministry. So the second day and the second to last before Jesus is crucified. So let's open up to John chapter 1. In John chapter 1, Jesus comes to John the Baptist. John the Baptist points at him and says, "Behold, look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." And a couple of John's followers, Andrew and another unnamed disciple, who we assume is John because it's in the Gospel of John, they follow after Jesus and they spend the day with him. And then on day 2 of Jesus' ministry, Jesus comes to the same place and he finds someone else. It says, finding Philip, he said to Philip, who would be one of the 12, he said, "Follow me." And so Philip followed after him. And Philip did not want to be alone in this journey, and so he went to find one of his friends. He had a friend named Nathanael. And in The Desire of Ages, it tells us that Nathanael, as he had seen Jesus proclaimed as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, he began to wonder, is this really the Messiah? Is John the Baptist correct? And he went to be by himself, and he found himself in a grove of trees. And in the midst of this trees, where he could be alone, he was praying, "God, give me direction." And it was here that Philip found his friend, Nathanael. And he said, "Philip, or Nathanael, we have found the one that Moses wrote about in the law, about whom the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the Son of God. This is the one we've been waiting for. This is the one you've been praying about. And we have found him, Jesus of Nazareth." And how does Nathanael respond? You guys know this story. What does he say? "Nazareth? Puh. Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip was very calm and cool and collected about this. You know, in today's society, we really like to argue about things. Have you ever been with somebody who just likes to argue about every single thing? If you're online, if you're looking at an article, at the end of the article, there's always comments and people begin to argue about the silliest little things, the most minuscule little things. And sometimes when we're with our friends and our family, we find ourselves arguing. And a few moments later, it's like, we agree with each other. Why are we arguing? Because our culture, our nature, is we want to argue with somebody. Philip, at least in this case, was not like that. Nathanael said, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip simply said, "Come and see. Come and check it out for yourself. And as these two gentlemen are coming back to where Jesus was, Jesus proclaims to him in John chapter 1, verse 47, it says, when Jesus saw Nathanael approaching, he said of him, here is a true Israelite in whom there is nothing false. Here is someone who I know is honestly, earnestly trying to seek after God. Here is a true Israelite. This is someone who wants to know the truth, who wants to follow the truth. And then verse 48, we see Nathanael's response. In today's terms, he would say, you don't know me. You think you know me, but you don't know me. How do you know me? Nathanael asked. And Jesus said, I saw you while you were still under the fig tree before Philip called you. A simple little statement. I saw you while you were still under the fig tree and Philip called you. And that was enough for Nathanael. Verse 49, it says, Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. Because Nathanael knew that when he was praying in that tree that he was alone, that nobody knew where he was except for Philip. And Jesus could not have seen him there unless there was something more. And yet it seems like such a small thing. And Jesus responds in verse 50. Jesus said, you believe because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? That's it? That was all it took for you to believe? You shall see greater things than that. You saw that small little thing, but let me tell you, brother, you ain't seen nothing yet. You're going to see so much more. Do we ever find ourselves in life wanting to see the big things, the big miracles that God has promised? And sometimes we fail to see the small things in life. We fail to see how God is blessing us on a daily basis because we're waiting in anticipation for the big thing to take place. And so we miss out on the little blessings that God gives us. We get distracted from the little blessings that we have. We overlook the little blessings that God gives us. We forget how God is at work in our life. And it's easy to do that. Just this week, think about things that could have distracted your understanding. If you have any news going on or seeing anything happening in the world, there's lots of things that could have distracted us. There's chemical attacks in different parts of the world. There's truck attacks. There's missiles being launched across the world. I think I have a picture of a missile up there. So, yeah, there's a missile being shot. There's that, but that's across the world. You know, that's a long ways from here. But here in Georgia, what have we had this week? Well, we had a nice sunny day. And then we had, there was tornadoes. There was wind. Oh, wind, that's nothing. When you leave the GCA campus, notice there's a little yellow house just before you cross the railroad tracks. Oh, wind's nothing. Except this giant tree that came like 6 inches from smushing the entire house. Wind's nothing. Hail falling from the sky, damaging cars. There's lots of things that we have to distract us, and that's just things we see on the news. But then we've got the everyday things, the challenges at work, the projects at school, the family issues, the relationship. All these different things can distract us from seeing the small things that God has. We won't take the time today. But I want you to think for just a moment. We won't take the time to share it, but think about a blessing that God has shown you in the last 24 hours, in the last 7 days. How has God shown up in your life? Was it a blessing of protection from storms? Was it a blessing of safe travel from wherever you may have journeyed? Was it a financial blessing that was unexpected? Was it a medical blessing, a health blessing? Was it simply the blessing of somebody giving you a smile or giving you a hug and telling you to have a nice day? Was it a time when you opened up God's word and you saw the verse that spoke to you that you needed on that particular day? Was that a blessing? All these things, these little things that we so often overlook. What did Nathanael see? Jesus said, you saw that little thing, But you're going to see greater things than that. Think about the things that Nathanael and Philip saw as they continued to journey with Jesus. That's in John chapter 1. If you just take your finger and scroll through the chapters of John, John chapter 2, just read the titles, the headlines. Jesus changes water to wine in John chapter 2. John chapter 4, Jesus heals the official's sons. John chapter 5, Jesus heals the man who was sick for 30-some years. John chapter 6, Jesus feeds the 5,000. Jesus walks on the water, and it goes on and on. John chapter 9, Jesus heals a man born blind. John chapter 11, Jesus raises Lazarus from the dead. Jesus said, you will see greater things than this. And Nathanael was privileged to see those greater things. And even as we remember the miracles that Jesus performed, it's easy to forget, or it's easy to get distracted, or it's easy to say, oh, that was for Nathanael. That was for Philip. They were disciples. They had a little something extra special. And even as we hear someone share a story with us about how God has blessed in their life, it's easy to say, wow, God is helping you. Why doesn't he seem to be helping me? Why do I continue to seem to live an aimless life, to live a life of no direction, to live a life where it seems as if God has forgotten me and forgotten where I'm supposed to be? So fast forward from Nathanael and Philip. 3.5 years from the second day of Jesus' public ministry to the second to last day of Jesus' public ministry. You think about the last week of Jesus. Tomorrow, much of the world is celebrating Palm Sunday, leading up to Good Friday, Easter, and then Easter Sunday, as the world focuses at least for a few moments on the death and the resurrection of Jesus. So on Sunday, Jesus did the triumphal entry. He came into Jerusalem, and on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, he preached in the temple, and he interacted with different people. But then on Thursday is where the story really begins to pick up pace as it drives to the cross. Because on Thursday, Jesus told his disciples to prepare an upper room. And they gather in the upper room for the Lord's Supper. Jesus washes the feet of the disciples. And on Thursday evening, just hours before the cross, Jesus has some time to share some thoughts, some closing thoughts with his disciples. And we find ourselves in John chapter 14. John chapter 14 has some great, great passages. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go, I come again. Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. It's got some great passages in there. But in verse 8, Philip speaks, same Philip that Jesus had talked to before when it was Philip and Nathanael. Philip said, verse 8, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough. And then in verse 9, Jesus answered. And sometimes I picture Jesus, you know, with this, the head slap meme. Have you ever seen that one? Sometimes I see Jesus doing that with the disciples. Show us the Father, that will be enough. And Jesus, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been among you for such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? And then in verse 11, Jesus continues, believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Believe these words that I'm saying. I and the Father are one. Believe me when I tell you this. But then notice what Jesus says. Or at least believe on the evidence of the miracles themselves. Nathanael, Philip, I told you, you were going to see greater things. And you've seen greater things. Water to wine, walking on water, dead raised. If you don't believe the words I'm saying, at least believe these greater things that you have seen. You see, that's the purpose of the miracles. Jesus didn't do miracles simply to ooh and ah people. Do we have any magicians in the house, you know, sleight of hands, pick a card, any card, anybody, a few people? All right. I love it when people can do that because I'm just amazed. I know what they're doing, but it still gets me every time. But Jesus was not doing sleight of hand. He was not doing trickery. He was doing things that no one else could do. He was walking on the water. He was calling the dead back to life. Jesus said, even if you don't believe what I say, believe the miracles. There was another time, and it's in Mark chapter 2, where Jesus is preaching, and there's a crowd there. There's a gentleman who's paralyzed. And his friends pick him up in his Eno hammock and they bring him to the crowd, but he can't fight, they can't fight the way through to get to Jesus. And so they somehow make their way up to the top, up to the roof. And in an act of destruction, vandalism for a good cause, they tear the roof open and they lower that hammock down to the feet of Jesus. And what is Jesus' first words? What does he say to the man? He said, "Your sins are forgiven." And the people said, "Whoa, whoa, 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 hold on, hold a second there, Jesus. You can't forgive sins. Only God can forgive sins. This is blasphemy." And then Jesus said, reminded us of what this purpose for these miracles are. I want to go to Mark chapter 2 and verse 10. Jesus says, he's talking to these critics, and in Mark 2, verse 10, he says, "I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." And then he said to the man, so he's talking to the critics, "I want you to know that I can forgive people." And then he turns to the man one-on-one, and he says in verse 11, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." And this miracle that I'm doing is to show all these people that I have the power to forgive sins. Jesus told Nathanael and Philip, "You shall see greater things." And then at the closing hours of Jesus' public ministry, he says, "You saw the greater things. Now believe me because of the things that you saw." But Jesus isn't done in John chapter 14. Verse 12, he continues. He says, "I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me will do what I have been doing. He will do even greater things than these because I am going to the Father." Whoa, keep that verse there. We're going to unpack this just real quickly here. I tell you the truth. Anyone who has faith in me. This is not a promise for the superhero Christian. This is not a promise simply for those that are disciples. This is not a promise for Peter or for Paul or for your pastor or your principal or your Bible teacher. This is a promise for everyone who believes in me. Who's that? That's all of us. This is supposed to be common Christianity. This is supposed to be the norm. Everyone who believes in me, then wow, will do greater things. We'll do the works that I have been doing. What's Jesus been doing? Raising the dead? Walking on water? Is this what it's talking about? And they will do even greater things than these. In Desire of Ages, it says this is not about more magnificent, more spectacular things. How can you get more spectacular than saying Lazarus come forth after he's been dead for 4 days? But it's talking about greater in the extent. Because when Jesus was done preaching, when Jesus went to the cross, there was only a couple hundred people in one place that believed in him. But because those disciples who at this moment are hours away from watching Jesus die on the cross, are days away from seeing a resurrected Savior, because those disciples are at a place where they are about to see the greatest thing that Jesus could do. They are about to see this death and this resurrection, this whole plan of Christianity, this whole plan of salvation poured out. Jesus died, but through the power of his Holy Spirit, the body of Christ, that's all of us, the body of Christ could go to the whole world to share greater things, greater than a miracle, greater than healing one person, but sharing the message of forgiveness and grace to the whole world. The disciples were hours from the cross, and soon they would have a story to share. And guess what? We have that same story to share. There's a quote from Desire of Ages, page 667. It says, "God did not design that his wonderful plan to redeem men should achieve only insignificant results. Jesus didn't come to this earth. He didn't leave heaven. He didn't die for, oh, it doesn't matter if people believe it or not. It's just, you know, a little vacation from heaven. Jesus did not design that his wonderful plan to redeem men should achieve only insignificant results. Jesus died for the world, and he wants the world to know it, and he wants the world to hear about it. In Acts 1, verse 8, it says, you will receive power. You, plural, you all, y'all, as we say, will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. Jesus says, you will do greater things than I have done. God has a plan for you. Sometimes when we are praying to God, when we're seeking out God's will, we are thinking about the small things. They're important things, but they're small. Lord, help me to do good on this test that I have. Help me to, at the office, to do this particular project well. God, where should I go to college? Those are important things, but they're small in the whole scope. Jesus says, you will do greater things than I have done, because God has a plan for you. He has a plan that is more incredible than simply finishing your homework or getting that date to the banquet. But by the power of the Holy Spirit, you can impact the entire world for Jesus, starting with those that are around you. We are called to be bold, to be brave, to be unwavering. We are called to be fearless because God has a plan for us. And as we see the small things, the little things that God has done, we can see the greater things that God has done. But God isn't finished because God wants us to do even greater things than that. Greg had moved from Poland, had gotten caught up in the drug culture. He was arrested for drug trafficking, for gun possession. Again, this is a different Greg. Sentenced to 9 years in prison. And very early on in his prison sentence, he was in the prison library and he opened up a book that was there. It was a book called The Great Controversy. And he says he read it from cover to cover. And his words were, this was true. This is the truth. I believe that this is the truth. He began to study the Bible. Soon he was baptized in prison. He began to do Bible studies with other prisoners in prison. Many of them accepted Jesus and decided to give their hearts and their life to God. When his time was up, he was released from prison. But he was deported back to Poland, where he had left when he was 3 years old. So he didn't know the language, he didn't know the people, but that was his nation of origin, and so that's where he was sent because of the crimes that he had committed. And so when he ended up in Poland, he began to teach English, because he knew English, and he had a hobby, and his hobby was making videos for YouTube. That was a hobby that he had. And soon, he decided, you know what, I want to continue to share this gospel message. So he began to make Christian-based YouTube videos. You know, what does the Bible say about salvation? 5 facts about the Sabbath, 5 signs that Jesus is coming soon, all these different things. And as time progressed, today, Greg is the top Adventist YouTuber. He has 180,000 subscribers to his channel. Many people have, from watching these videos, have begun, following Jesus, have begun asking questions. He actually supports his wife and children from making YouTube videos. I wouldn't recommend that as a career, goal, but some people can do it. In fact, it's said that he reaches more people for Jesus on his YouTube channel than all the pastors in Poland do. This person who was a prisoner, this person who was locked away, this person who was fearful, who was unsure of what life would even hold for him, Jesus said, you're going to see greater things, and not only that, you are going to do greater things. And God has those same promises in mind for us. God has a plan for you. And so our challenge is to open our eyes so that we can see the things that God is doing. We can see the small things, and we can see the greater things of how he is working in your life. And we can recognize that God has challenged us, that by the power of his Spirit, we can do greater things. So as we leave this service today, I want to give you a challenge. What are you going to do this week that's going to be different than last week? I know GCA students are going to go home for home leave, so that's going to be different. That's going to be exciting. But what else? I want you to pray, a particular prayer. I want you to pray for two things. One, I want you to pray to God. Say, God, open my eyes. Help me to see what you are doing in my life. Whether it's a small thing or whether it's a great thing, help me to see what you are doing. God, open my eyes. And then the second prayer is, God, open my mouth. God, help me to share what you are doing in my life. And help me to have the courage to tell somebody else. God, open my eyes. God, open my mouth. So that I can see greater things. And that by your Spirit, I can do greater things. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, you've done the greatest thing. You sent Jesus to this earth to leave heaven, to live and to die for us. Jesus came and did miracles, great things, incredible things, but pointing us to the salvation, to the grace that you have, to the death and the cross and the resurrection. Lord, we can see great things. Help us to see the little things as well. And Lord, as we recognize your work in our life, whatever the little plan is for us to do day by day, let us be part of the grand plan of winning this world to Jesus and telling everyone that you are coming soon. God, open my eyes. God, open my mouth. In your name we pray. Amen.